Well, good evening. No, it's not. Good morning. Whatever it is. Hello, everybody. Did you have a good Thanksgiving? Did you take time to thank him? I mean, really? Because, I mean, you know, that's really, I mean, the turkey was good. Actually, I had fried shrimp for Thanksgiving, but, yeah, that's right. But I had to go to Fats to get it. We tried to go to the Cracker Barrel. I thought I had this all planned out. And we showed up about 1:30, and there was a line for forever out there. So we went to Plan B pretty quickly. But I hope you had a good holiday. We had another family member go home to Jesus this week, and you know, Doug Brennan passed away, and we need to be in prayer for Merle and Jenna and the rest of the family this week as they bury him on Tuesday. So we wanted to kind of bring that up to let you know about it as we became aware of it. Tonight is the fish fry. I get to do announcements again today. Tonight is the fish fry. We need you to do something for us. All of you strong-backed, weak-minded individuals, because a lot of us qualify, we need you to come over and help us briefly after church and get the tables and chairs set up in the fellowship hall. I was just seeing if y'all are paying attention. And that would help us a great deal and keep us old people from having to do it. And then show up and have a good time with us tonight. We got to eat tonight. We ate last Sunday night, right? We're going to eat this Sunday night, right? Be here at 4 o'clock to cook. Now, if y'all want to know the secret to frying fish, that man right there will teach it to you. So show up at 4 o'clock to help him. And guess what? We're going to have to eat again next Sunday night. It's just, you know, I can't help you. And so we need some desserts. Next Sunday night is our kids are putting on a Christmas play for us and singing and dancing and stuff. And we're going to have a little social afterwards, so we'll need your help doing that also. Can you believe that Christmas is almost here? Now, Walmart and Sam's have been ready since Labor Day. You know, back when you could still wear white shoes, as they used to say, that you could go find some Christmas goodies out there. But it's coming now. And Christmas is a great time. It's a great time to celebrate and families and church, and we're looking forward to all that. But it's also a great time to invest and invite people to come with you. So here real fast is some things for the holidays that we want to make you aware of, not only for your benefit, but for you to begin to invest and invite in people to come and attend. So next Sunday night, in place of our normal service, our little wee ones are doing a play and singing for us, and then we're going to have that the little social afterwards. The following Sunday, our older youth are putting on a play and singing and dancing and stuff. And all of that's always very good. We have the most talented group of youth in this church. So they've been working very, very hard at it. And it's a time when we want you to invest and invite. And then on Christmas Eve, we're going to do something different this year. We've always done carols and candles and communion service. Well, we've renamed it. We're also going to do a fly by the seat of your pants Christmas play, which we're good at, by the way, that flying by the seat of your pants thing. So we're going to do a no rehearsal Christmas play as part of that service. It's going to be at 5 o'clock on Christmas Eve night. So we'll get out of here in time for you to get to every place you need to go. It's a great place to invite the kids to come and be part of a Christmas play. We have purchased some costumes, as they come in the door, they get to decide what costume they wish to wear until we run out. And it's going to be fun. It's going to get them engaged in the story, and it'll get us engaged in the story. So the staff doesn't know about that yet, but we're going to create a little card for you this week. You're welcome. And that'll have all of the activities on there. Because here's the deal for you. I'm going to teach you how to do this. How many of you still send Christmas cards? Paper Christmas cards, not electronic ones. Okay, how many of you still send them not here, where you actually mail them? You do know the post office needs you to mail more, right? I'm just here to tell you because they're broke. Here's a great idea for you. When you go and create your Christmas cards to mail them to local folks, why not take that little card that we're going to create for you and just that little invitation card and just stick it inside your Christmas card and send it? What an easy way to invite, right? And cause, you know, we're trying really hard to make it easy for you to invite. How many of you realize we still have plenty of cards? 7,500 of them to be plenty of cards. Now, how many of you are giving them away? That was kind of a tricky, that was a rhetorical question, but I appreciate you raising your hand, okay? Carol and I met a lady at Walmart the other day who makes pies here in Garden City. So I'm going to order me a pie, but I also gave her a card and invited her to participate. You with me? That's as simple as it gets, okay? And because what we have is what people need, but they don't know they need it until we invite them. All right, so if we're up and running technologically up there, let's do our message today. The Great Adventure. This is we've been doing this series of Not From Around Here, remembering that as Christians, as believers, our home is in heaven. We're just passing through here. While we have a citizenship here in the United States, we also have a more important citizenship in heaven, the scriptures tell us. We're foreigners here. And we've been walking through the First Peter, and we're going to look at that again today. If you grab a Bible or if you brought your Bible, we're going to be in First Peter chapter 3, and I'm going to read 8 through 17. So I'll give you I should have given you a heads up before that. First Peter, if you don't know where that is, go toward the back and work your way forward a little bit. A couple of little tiny books right there past Revelation. 1 Peter 3, 8 through 17. And the title of this thing is The Great Adventure. Did y'all wake up this morning going, all right, I'm going on a great adventure today? Some of you did. Some of you went down and fed the homeless today. Matter of fact, Gerald came in the office a while ago, and I couldn't figure out why I just had this urge to go to the Waffle House. And then I realized that's because they had been serving bacon and eggs down to the homeless folks this morning. So they've had a great adventure today. And God has created you and I, if we're Christ followers, God has created you and I to join Him in this great adventure called life. And so this morning, on this Sunday after Thanksgiving, where some of us are still in tryptophan overload, right? Where some of us are struggling to kind of feel perky today, I want you to feel perky today because God has created you in a most powerful way to join Him in this great adventure called life. Do you remember growing up reading all the adventure stories of Livingston, and you know, they go out and they find all these cool things, and the guy that climbed Mount Everest the first time, I mean, all those great stories. The adventure that God invites me and you to join is just as exciting as reading about those stories. I remember as a kid reading the book called Kon-Tiki, where these guys loaded up and came across the ocean in an old-fashioned boat, you know, and all the stories that went with that. I can remember reading the story of Lindbergh getting in an airplane by himself and flying across the Atlantic Ocean the first time. Those are exciting things. And I'm just here to tell you this morning that God has invited you and I to join Him in one of the great adventures ever. So let me read to you. 1 Peter 3:8-17. Finally, all of you, be like-minded, be sympathetic, love one another. Be compassionate and humble. Do not repay evil with evil or insult with insult. On the contrary, repay evil with blessing. Because of this you were called, so that you may inherit a blessing. For whoever would love life and see good days must keep his tongue from evil and their lips from deceitful speech. They must turn from evil and do good. They must seek peace and pursue it, for the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and His ears are attentive to their prayer. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. Who's going to harm you if you're eager to do good? But even if you should suffer for what is right, you're blessed. Do not fear their threats. Do not be frightened, but in your hearts, revere Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have, but do this with gentleness and respect, keeping a clear conscience. For those who speak maliciously against your good behavior in Christ may be ashamed of their slander. For it is better, if it is God's will, to suffer for doing good than for doing evil. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, to bring you to God. He was put to death in the body, but made alive in the spirit. This great adventure that God has called us to be, bold and brave adventurers. I'm not so sure that's exactly, if you look that up in the dictionary, whether you'd see my picture next to that or not. But that's what God calls us to do and encourages us to be part of. And, you know, there's some synonyms for adventurers. I looked these up. I thought that would be kind of cool. And here's a few out of my research. A swashbuckler. Y'all might look that up because I'm not completely sure what that is. A hero or a heroine. A traveler. A voyager. An explorer. A pathfinder. A pioneer. He's called us on this great adventure. But with that adventure comes some danger, doesn't it? And I want to make sure we understand today that as God has called us to join Him, as He's called us to give us a purpose for living greater than ourselves, that this isn't some Pollyanna kind of thing where we can wish it all away. The truth is, there are times when life is tough. There are times when being on this great adventure can be difficult, and we're going to talk about that today. But I hope you'll remember this thing, Ephesians 2:10, and I'd encourage you to write it down and then look it up. You can look it up now if you want to while I'm rambling on. But Ephesians 2:10 says it this way. He says, we are God's workmanship. Poema is the word. We are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. So what is it that God has prepared for us to do? Well, in this passage of Scripture, there are three things I want us to look at really fast today. There are three things that are important out of this passage that He's created us to do. The first one is that we're to live our faith. Not just talk our faith, but we're to live our faith. And he calls us to eagerly live for our faith. 1 Peter 3:13 implies that God looks for us to be eager to do good. And then he gives us this list of what this eagerness should look like. Finally, all of you live in harmony with one another, be sympathetic, love as brothers, etc., etc. So the list that's here in 1 Peter passage goes like this. Live in harmony. Be sympathetic. Love as brothers. Be compassionate. Be humble. Don't repay evil for evil, but repay it with blessing. Keep your tongues from evil and stay away from deceitful speech. Turn from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it. Pretty big project there, isn't it? Goes against how the world shows us how to live life. If you could do all of those things, it would be a big adventure, wouldn't it? Can you imagine what it would be like when somebody does bad to you if you did good back to them? How different you would be? The second thing he tells us that we're supposed to do is be bold with our faith. 1 Peter 3:14 commands us, do not fear what they fear. Do not be frightened. Anybody, don't raise your hand, anybody fearful about anything? Me and snakes would be a good one. Okay? Some of you with spiders, right? Some of you with more pressing issues, fear of getting sick, you know, fear of not run, you know, fear of running out of money. There's some real things we could be scared of. But the Bible is full of these instructions that tell us His people do not fear. So I got to looking up some of this for you, and I thought I'd kind of give you a few verses of Scripture. You can hear that from the preacher, and you go, yeah. But let me tell you what God says about it. Let me just read you a few verses about what God says about fear. In Psalm 27:1, it says, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? Isaiah 41:10 declares, so do not fear, so I am with you, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. And then Jesus said it this way. He says, peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. Max Lucado, who many of you read, and he's growing on me. Max Lucado says that it's hard to be a bold adventurer if you're conquered by fear. He says fear and boldness just don't go together, a lot like these things. He asks this question. He says that fear crowds out a good part of your life. He says, can one be happy and afraid at the same time? Can you have clear thinking and be afraid at the same time? Can you be confident and afraid? Can you be merciful and afraid? And he goes on to say that no fear is the playground bully that threatens to steal your lunch money when you show up. He says, fear never wrote a symphony nor a poem. Fear never negotiated a peace treaty or cured a disease. Fear never pulled a family out of poverty or a country out of bigotry. Fear never saved a marriage nor business. Courage does that. Courage does that. Now look, Paul wasn't dismissing the idea that fear and suffering isn't a real thing. He's pretty clear in this passage of Scripture that we can be righteous and live righteously and still come out with a bad outcome. He was very clear about that. That suffering and pain and crying and aggravating is part of life. But C.S. Lewis put it this way. He says, why do the righteous suffer? One of the age-old questions. Why do the righteous suffer? And then he says, why not? We're the ones best equipped to take it. Look, by myself, I am nothing. Yeah, I'm good looking, but I mean, by myself, I'm nothing. I'm not smart enough. I'm not strong enough. I'm not good enough. Okay, I'm not good looking enough. But with Jesus, I'm all those things. With Jesus, I can face tomorrow. And it's when we get in the well, when we get in that fog of tragedy, when we get in that fog of pain, when we get in that fog of unknown, we better have a little Jesus on our side. And it doesn't denigrate the idea that life is hard. I don't want you to hear that, because it can be. Because we live in a fallen world. We live with people that have a birth defect, sin. Because you and I have that same birth defect, sin. But because of Jesus, he can heal that birth defect. And so I want you to understand that today, as I'm standing here before you today, some of us need to be reminded that we are more than survivors. Now, sometimes it feels that way. Lord, if you would just get me through today. I got that. I've been to that party. Lord, if you'll just get me through this week. Lord, if you'll just do this for me, I'll be okay. But Lord, I can't do it. You got to do it for me. And I want you to understand that Jesus said that Jesus did not die on that cross just so his people could limp to the end. He said, I've come to give you life, and life in its full is what he says. And even in those times, even in that moment, because some of you are in that moment now, understand that he has come to overcome this world that we live in. And if we hang in there with him, if we keep doing what he tells us to do, we will get to the other side. God calls us to be adventurers and overcomers. And yep, some of us walk with a limp. Some of us have scars. Some of us need people that'll come alongside us at times and walk with us, because we can't walk by ourselves. Some of us, most of us here, know the story about the footprints in the sand. That is just absolutely an overworked thing. But it's overworked because it's true. When you think he's not there, he's the one carrying you. And if you've ever experienced coming out of that with him carrying you, you know how true it is. The third thing and last thing I want to share with you this morning. Go back one. Look here. There's an old saying that's been part of our community for a long time, and it is that we will overcome. There's a song in there, we will overcome. You understand me? Well, the only ones that can really sing that song correctly are believers. The only way we can sing that song and really mean it is if you're a believer. We are overcomers because Jesus said he came and overcome the world. He came and overcame the world. Do not fear. Last thing, real fast. In that passage of Scripture, it says that we need to be ready to give an answer for our faith or our hope. So how do you do that, preacher? That's a complicated thing, isn't it? Being able to on demand give my testimony, to be able to on demand tell somebody why Jesus is the most important thing that can come into their life, to be able to tell them why Christianity is the best way to live and the only way to die. How do you do that? Well, I'm going to make it easy for you. It's five little steps. You ready? Here they go. Number one, life is short. Number two, eternity is long. Number three, sin is black. Number four, hell is real. Number five, heaven can be yours. 7 million Georgians are facing eternity today without any hope. And most of them don't even know it. Most of them don't even know it. They've been raised in a culture where they have not received any sort of heritage of knowing what Christianity is like. Why do you think all of the bucket heads are protesting against having anything to do with Christianity in the school system? They don't know any better. We watched it this morning. Somebody is fussing because they want to teach Bible as literature and history in the classroom as an elective. But somebody says you can't do that. Well, it'd be easy to be mad about that, okay? Because they are bucketheads. But they don't know any better. They don't know any better. Now, they may not hear the answer to their problem, but our culture has gotten so far away from understanding this need to have a relationship with somebody bigger, better, smarter than we are. So you need to be prepared as a believer to give an answer for your hope. And the five real quick steps is life is short, eternity is long, sin is black, hell is real, but heaven can be yours. I had a chance this morning to show my artistic skills and draw for somebody the picture of the world. On one side there's a mountain, and on that mountain there I am. And on the other side is another mountain, and on that mountain is God. And between those two mountains is empty space. There's 100 yards going between me and Jesus, right? Or between me and God. And I can be, I told him this morning, I can be good and smart and live a good life, and I can jump 20 yards across that 100-yard chasm, and what does it make me? Dead would be the word. I could be just super spiritual, and I could be in Sunday school, and I can be a deacon, and I can tithe, and I can come to church every Sunday, and I can have a 30-year never-miss Sunday school pin, and I can jump 70 yards across that 100-yard gap, and what am I? Dead. I can't get to God on my own because of my birth defect called sin. But Jesus came. Jesus came, and on that cross, he split the deal for me. He connected the sides up. He built a bridge so that I could get from my side of the mountain to God's side of the mountain. And for me to get from where I am to where He is, I just have to cross the bridge. I have to recognize that without Him, I'm dead. But because of what He did on that cross and that blood He shed for me, once I recognize that I'm dead, and if the only thing that can happen for me is to cross that bridge, is to come alive again, I have to do that through Jesus. As I told that person this morning, the first thing I needed to do was discover I was a sinner. And that because I'm a sinner, I can't get to God by myself. A miracle has to happen. And that miracle is called Jesus. I have to confess my sin and tell Him, yep, I did it. I did it. And then accept His gift of forgiveness and repentance. And that blood He shed for me on that cross cleansed my sin. So here's the question. You got it? You got it? Because if you got it, good for you. Thank you, Jesus. If you don't got it, you can have it. You can have it as simply as confessing your sin, just calling it what Jesus called it, asking for His forgiveness, turn from your life and go the other way. And if you've never done that and would like to do that and us help you, Randall, and I'll be up front, Randall, if you'll come on forward, we'll be happy to do that. Now, those of you that said you got it, what are you going to do with it? You see, He didn't give it to you just so you can sit on it. He didn't give it to you just so you can gloat and go to heaven. He gave it to you so that you now are the carrier of the gospel. You're the carrier of that salvation, that same salvation that saved you. He then puts you, He puts that in your hands to go tell others. One way to do that is to invite them to come to these things we talked about this morning and let them experience the love and grace of Christ. One way to do that is to be prepared to share your faith and the reason for your hope. One way to do that is to join this congregation in its mission going forward to reach the lost. And if today's the day you'd like to come and join us here in that family of believers, then we'll be open to receive you here today also. As we get ready to leave this morning and head out to wherever we're going this afternoon to get ready for the fish fry tonight, I want to pray for you, and then this will be our dismissal, okay? Father God, we come before you today, and Lord, we're trying to hear you about this whole adventure thing. Lord, some of us have started out well, and then we hit a little trouble spot, and maybe not doing quite as well as we mean to, and so, God, I pray that you would encourage us today and remind us today that we can get back and on that adventure anytime we're ready, that you're ready for us. Lord, some of us have been doing this for a long time, and we're grateful for that. We may be a little tired, but, Lord, I pray you would energize us and to remind us that the job's not done, and that if we're still breathing, our best days may still be ahead of us. And Lord, some of us may not have started that journey yet, but are kicking the tires and blowing the horn and checking all of that out in this walk with you. And so God, I pray you'd continue to speak to them and encourage them to be open to seeking you. Lord, those that are here today whose hearts are heavy and who's tender, God, I pray your protection and provision for them, and that you remind them that everywhere they go, you go with them. And Lord, all these people in our neighborhoods who need you, who need to know of that hope, I pray, God, you'd give us opportunities to talk to them and teach them. Lord, we love you. Look forward to all that you have for us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.